Thank you for being here, and welcome to our session on effective global communications during an emergency. My name is Kathryn Brock. I'm the Director of the Division of Preparedness and Response in the Office of Nuclear Security and Incident Response here at the NRC. So I'll begin with a few logistics that you're probably already comfortable with at this point. The format of our session is going to be each speaker will speak for around 10 minutes, and then at the end, we will take questions. And so you can use the QR code, if you can put that up, please. You can use the QR code, and I think online you also have an opportunity to enter some questions. So we'll get those ready and loaded up so that when it's time, we'll have lots of good conversation and questions. Okay. So continuing with the session, geopolitical events are changing, and communication is changing. We need to be ready faster than ever to provide information to decision makers and to the public using modern communication methods. With us today, we have practitioners of communications who have experience communicating with the public from a variety of vantage points. We have Peter Kaiser from the International Atomic Energy Agency. He's going to talk with us about sensemaking when communicating during a crisis. David Castelveter from the NRC's Office of Public Affairs, our director, will talk about the fundamentals in communication and public trust. Benjamin Weiss is a reporter. He comes to us from the Courthouse News Service, and he's going to talk to us about his experiences in getting accurate messages to the public. Kathryn Higley is from Oregon State University. She's a professor and certified health physicist. And she'll talk with us about her experiences in communicating tough scientific issues with the public. Agnieszka Makosa from the National Atomic Energy Agency in Poland, and Roman Halenka from the State Nuclear Regulatory Inspectorate of Ukraine are here to talk with us about the challenges of public communications while under the aggression of the Russian Federation in Ukraine. We hope that through these presentations, we'll all have a better appreciation of the communication complexities and how to apply the right tools at the right time for the right audience. So we'll start the session with Peter.
Thanks, Kathy, and thank you for having me. Today, I just wanted to give you some idea of a tool, a method that, a tool or a method that I think might be very useful for all of us who are involved in public communication when dealing with a crisis like the one that we are dealing with in Ukraine. So it is called sensemaking, and as you might have heard yesterday from the Director General's remarks, the IAEA Director General Grossi was saying that this is not business as usual for anyone who's involved with it. The IAEA has field teams right now at all five of the Ukrainian nuclear power plants. The incident and emergency center where I work, we are in continuous operation, and we maintain frequent contact with our Ukrainian colleagues just to be certain that we can provide the public with accurate and up-to-date information. And that's the goal. That was what the Director General was talking about, is that we cannot communicate as experts. We have to communicate empathetically and in plain language frequently so that we can provide information that people will believe is trustworthy, and it must remain, as the Director General said, laser precise. So to do that, I just wanted to show you a methodology called sensemaking that's been around for a while. It's a relatively simple mental framework, and it builds team resilience because, of course, we all communicate with subject matter experts, with our management, and it also builds public trust because it can deliver the messages that respond to the public's real needs. Now, the response to the Ukraine crisis is like many other crises that public communicators face. It is characterized by a lot of confusion in the beginning, an absolute scarcity of quality information, and at the same time, a great deal of uncertainty among the experts about what's going to happen next. And despite those challenges, we public communicators still have to give the public the information they need to be able to make informed choices about their own safety. Now, the photo you see here is a typical situation for public communicators. I've taken this from the Twitter channel of the California Governor's Office of Emergency Services. It shows communicators in something called a joint information center. So these are people, communicators, who are from different California state agencies responding to last year's wildfires, and they come from public health, police, transportation, emergency medical services, forest fire, death services, and other services together. And the reason why they're sitting in one room looking at social media monitoring, looking at live TV reporting, is to be able to develop a common understanding of the situation. That's sense-making in, let's say, practical terms. Now, the photo you see here was taken at it's called the Fish Pond. It's near the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant. During that accident and after that accident, emergency responders around the world changed their emergency public communication processes. We published a safety standard on it. And the reason why I'm showing you that photo is just to make you aware of the, let's say, the technical background necessary to be able to respond to a nuclear radiological emergency. And it's very, very difficult, as we were discussing earlier amongst the colleagues here, to deliver that information understandably. And as Roman best knows of the panel here, we are also continually updating our procedures to be able to deal with the current situation in Ukraine. And the question that people have for me, which is why I'm always looking for new protocols, promising protocols, member states ask me, how do we adapt? How can we be confident that the way we change our tools is going to work? And I want to show you something. Down at the bottom of the screen, you can barely see it, is a link to an article from a professor at the Netherlands Defense Academy in 2019. His name is J.P. Kalkman. In 2019, he did a series of experiments where he simulated with public communicators in exercises terrorist attacks, and he wanted to find out how do they cope, what works and what doesn't. And what he did find out, which is quite useful, is that we actually only have to answer three questions as a team to be able to improve our collaboration and productivity significantly. So I'm going to go through those three questions really fast. The first one's pretty obvious: what's happening? The second one is, who am I, which is a pretty strange question. And the third one is, how do my actions matter? And the reason why these questions need to be continually asked is because you're going to be responding to emergencies with a diverse team of different disciplines from different agencies with, let's say, different cultural expectations. And therefore, you have to find a way to respond to a really dynamic situation in a very, very coherent and understandable, predictable way. So if you don't answer those questions, you simply don't know what the answers are, or you're assuming that the answer is one that you like, and it may not be, in which case you have to enter into dialogue, which is why these three questions are the critical questions. Let's apply this to the way that the IAEA has adapted itself to be able to respond to the ongoing threats to nuclear safety in Ukraine as a result of the war. So here you see in a graphic compressed into the simplest possible terms the types of events that have taken place that have threatened nuclear safety there over the past year, actually more. And you can see that all five nuclear power plants have been affected in some way, as you well know, and different types of events have taken place, everything from occupation to missile overflights. Each one of these events, as our colleagues from Ukraine report them to us, and as our teams report them to us, cause an event in our own communication. We have to find a way to deal with it. We have to find out what's happening. And at the very beginning, we go back to the 24th of February last year, and certainly when we go back to the 3rd of March last year, when Zaporozhye was occupied under armed attack, we had to adapt our processes overnight to be able to manage one of the inevitabilities of a crisis, and that is what you're hoping will work, doesn't work. In other words, the Ukrainian regulator's website was no longer accessible, and the website of the operator was no longer accessible, so that we didn't have that source of information. We just had the telephone and Telegram, which is a social media platform that some of you may know. And so we overnight created a process to be able to monitor social media, not just Telegram, 24/7. We have on-call IAEA staff members who are fluent in Ukrainian so that we can be able to keep up to date. That was the first, let's say, major adaptation that the war brought. The next one, next question, I should say, is who are we in this crisis? That's very easy for us in the Incident Emergency Center to answer. That question is answered for us by two emergency conventions and a number of resolutions taken by the IAEA's general conference. So we know what we need to do, and we exercise it on a regular basis. The picture you see there shows an emergency response manager and the DG's advisor for nuclear safety discussing volubly about an emergency exercise which was going on in October 2021. It was a global nuclear emergency exercise. So in this case, we didn't need to adapt. We just needed to make sure that we delivered within the mandates we were given. But it was the third question that I think has the most dramatic results for us, is that we were asking ourselves, if we follow the procedures we normally follow, given the unprecedented nature of the breaches of, say, nuclear safety in Ukraine, will we be able to deliver on our mandate if we do the same old thing? And we didn't. The Director General, and you heard him yesterday, he wanted to have a communication with the public and with stakeholders that really would be easily understandable, and so he created his own format, the Director General's update. We've issued about 150 updates since the war began. That was on the simple side, but internally to create the updates, and this is the reason why I'm showing this to you, is that these three questions can lead to some significant internal cultural shifts. So here you see in a diagram the very linear, step-by-step, thorough vetting process for public messaging during an emergency. It starts with a public information officer, it moves to the emergency response manager who's actually running the incident operations center. Then it moves on to various directors, a deputy director general, and then the director general himself. Then on to the member state, then it comes back to the emergency response manager. If every one of those steps is taken diligently and within the time frame, that's a 2-hour process, and we just didn't have the time. And more importantly, the situation was evolving so quickly that if in the process something changed, you needed to change that update. If you needed to change the update, the whole process would have to be restarted. Again, you'd be investing another 2 hours. So this was the cultural shift. Now we're dealing with classic sense making. Classic sense making means that we are all together involved in the communication. We're not in separate silos or bubbles, and we can see what the others are thinking and what the others are concerned about. So here you have the Director General, management, the spokesperson, social media team, and all the subject matter experts that are relevant for a particular update on a particular, let's say, safety event. They can see what's being developed. We share everything via email. Everybody can jump in when they need to provide input. And it's a much faster, much more durable process, and also one that can adapt very quickly. And this is the reason why I want to show it to you, is that sense making will require some cultural shifts, but it won't require an investment in equipment. It won't require an investment in training. It will just simply require the willingness to bring everybody around the same table. You will gain productivity, you'll gain resilience, and you'll gain agility through this. It may not be appropriate for every kind of emergency response, and there's one kind of response for which I would certainly suggest we should be cautious, and that is the very initial 15 to 20 minutes of a response. There you should follow the procedures as written as quickly as possible. But as events evolve, as this picture shows, that's from the night of the 3rd to the 4th of March 2022, you can be swiftly overwhelmed by events, and a number of disciplines need to come together quickly to be able to develop the kind of communication that would help the public understand safety hazards and also to support your team in understanding the event. So I just wanted to put this on the table as a possible tool. We're going to try to put it into our guidance, and I just wanted to, with this, just to introduce it to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. David.
Thanks, Kathryn. I want to first thank you, Kathy. It was your idea to have this panel, and I think it was a brilliant idea, and your staff who has worked very hard on this. As you can see, my colleagues came a very long distance to be here, not just other countries, Kathryn from Oregon, and they felt it important enough to be at an NRC regulatory information conference. So a warm thank you to all for that. And Peter, you've been a friend for quite some time, and while you don't work for the NRC, you and the IAE have really been instrumental in helping pull this group together. So a very warm thanks to you as well. You'll be happy to know that while I have a written script, I don't follow it, I never do. I won't be reading to you, and you'll regret that because I will go off on a tangent at some point, and my staff who's here in the room, when I get back to the office, will rip madly into me and say, why did you say that? But it's just the way I am. But I tell you that because one of the importances of what we do requires flexibility, agility, resilience. And over the course of the last couple of days, I was listening to the presentation and the buzzwords that have been using, that have been used, and how they apply to us. I was thinking, and I had recently been in Abu Dhabi and then not long ago at the IAEA ministerial, and we talk a lot about climate change, and we talk about building trust. And to overuse an overused term, I've heard so many times over the last day and a half that we're facing challenging times. And I started to think to myself, what does that mean, the challenging time, as I was combining what others have been saying. And as Peter mentioned, the war in Ukraine has created new challenges, not just for the nuclear industry, but us as communicators. Issues related to climate change have created challenging times because there seems to be a renewed interest. I won't call it a renaissance, but there seems to be a renewed interest in nuclear energy. That's challenging times. But again, building trust in the communities through how we communicate continues to be the most perplexing part of all of this to me. We were having a sidebar conversation, Kathryn and Peter and I, before this session started, and we were listening to the various panelists talk about how will you convince the public to trust you? And, you know, during a media session yesterday, one of the reporters said how nice it is that, you know, you're establishing all of these practices and procedures to gain the public trust, but how are you going to get the public to trust what you're doing? And, you know, it took a little bit of thinking to be able to address the question. And then as we chatted this morning, we said to ourselves, wow, it really is a challenge for us to say, how can we optimize or maximize the work that we do to build that public trust? So then it translated to me to the challenges we as communicators face. And I'm gonna rewind way back to when I was a youngster, and you can tell by the lack of hair and the gray hair, I've been on Earth quite a while, but I was thinking about when I first became a journalist and when I first worked in public relations. I typed press releases on an old Selectric typewriter, and to make copies, I had carbon copy. And at one point, there was something called a mimeograph. So then you can make multiple copies. And then you addressed envelopes, and you put your press release in the envelope. And then if it was going to be a news item that was untimely, you had to find ways to get it to the media who had interest in it, and then you would hand deliver it to the reporters that were in your area, because it all had to be nicely coordinated. But we didn't have technology, we didn't have email. And then when email came along, we started emailing, you know, press releases out. And then came this beast called social media. And I remember when social media was introduced, experts were saying, this is going to challenge all of us because there are no laws, there are no rules that govern what is valid or invalid information using social media. It hasn't been tested. You know, the laws of malice, the laws of that protect people from liable didn't apply. You know, journalists who used to be credentialed journalists were no longer credentialed because they either had a blog or they had some sort of a social media account and they put information out there. And then you had to start saying to yourself as communicators, how can I use that tool to my best interest? And how can I be aware of the information that is out there on social media that might be misinformation or disinformation? And you know, there's a uniqueness between misinformation and disinformation. For my colleagues from across the pond, they look at football different than we do. But some of you might remember, it wasn't that long ago that during a National Football League game, a player for the Buffalo Bills had a great defensive play, and he hit an offensive runner, and he fell to the ground, and he got up. And within seconds, he fell to the ground. And for the first time ever in American football, he had to go through, he went through resuscitation. His heart stopped twice. They put the defibrillator on him. And then they carted him off the field, and you know, praise be, he lived. That young man was from my hometown and members, friends of the family. But I tell you that because for 2.5 hours, maybe 3 hours, nobody had any idea what was happening. The National Football League made no announcements. The teams made no announcements. The public address announcers made no announcements. And all of the information that the announcers were giving about this football player was coming from social media. Players on the field that were tweeting. Other people in the stands that were saying, this is what I'm seeing, what I'm feeling. And the interesting part to me was those sportscasters had to determine how much of this was legitimate, how much of it was worth speaking to, and how much was it worth dismissing. Whether it was misinformation or disinformation, I realized again that social media is a beast that is our friend, but at many times it's our enemy. We have to figure out today, differently than when I was a youngster, how to use that. And I know my staff oftentimes gets tired of me saying this, but you know, our communications not that long ago were news releases and interactions with the media. Today, I think that traditional news releases, and Ben can attest to this as a reporter, are still looked at as valuable communications tools. But it's complemented. Social media it complements the social media that we put out. When we were doing our emergency exercises, our exercises were basically news releases, and then we tweeted. So we finally, as a group, said, you know, if we're going to build public trust, if we're going to get information out there and we're going to get it out there quickly, we have to start using social media. And we have to put snippets of information out there so that we're continually reminding the public that we know what's going on, we're in charge, and the actions that were taken. And then the more detailed communications related to that, emergency communications, would then be the news releases. And I'm not a proponent of putting things out for the sake of putting them out, but you have to be visible. Part of the sidebar conversation that we were having earlier was that if you're not out there, and you're not out there quickly, you leave yourself to other people to comment. And that's those bloggers, and that's those people who claim to be experts, because the media are looking for people who are talking heads. And if we're not out there allaying the fears of the public by what we know, then what's happening is other people are driving the narrative. And we're playing defense, to use a sports term, and not offense. So our focus is to get out there quickly you know, to make sure that we're communicating the message that we want to communicate relative to what the event is. And Kathy was very kind to accept the recommendation that I had, and that was to treat this panel as not just emergencies or crises, but both. Because I think, as everybody knows, every emergency isn't a crisis, right? Every crisis is an emergency. And we looked at, and we continually look at crises as some sort of a radiological disbursement. But the history for us is there hasn't been anything in the United States since Three Mile Island. So we use as a backdrop Fukushima and Chernobyl. Well, now we have Ukraine and we have Zaporizhzhia to use as a baseline for some of the work that we do. But I'm also reminded that there are other emergencies that affect us, and we have those emergencies under control, but the public doesn't necessarily understand or believe. And specifics are hurricanes, flooding events, extreme weather events, hot, heat, you know, cold weather. And the public wants to know, are they safe when these events happen? So while we look at crisis, we can't ignore emergencies. And we do train, and when we train, we actually, our exercises are mostly emergency driven and not crisis driven. It's some sort of a radiological release, but not to the level of a crisis, if you want to characterize it that way. So we train, we do, and I'm gonna go over some of the fundamentals, and I ask that you just indulge me, but it's like if anybody plays the game of golf, there's something called muscle memory. You know, at some point, your muscles tell you what to do. You don't have to think too much about it because you practice. And that's the philosophy that we take at the NRC. Practice as you're going to play. And we practice and we practice and we practice and we train and we train and we train. Sometimes we overpractice, we overtrain. In my view, you can never overpractice or overtrain. And we do a whole lot of it. And we've been adapting our training to include our regional offices. At one point, it would be a headquarters emergency or it would be a regional emergency. And now we've integrated that training into a combination of the headquarters and the regional staff. We're incorporating tabletop exercises more into, or will be, tabletop exercises more into our emergency preparedness. And you know, that is you know, critical to us because, again, if you don't practice as you play, you kind of forget. And you don't have to go through the full-blown exercise when you're doing the tabletop, but it keeps you fresh. It keeps you on top of what you need to do, and it helps you adapt. The other thing that we're looking at, and I learned this from the IAEA, and I feel badly that it took me so long to figure it out, is our communications for emergency preparedness is social media. It is news releases. It is the old-fashioned, you know, have a media briefing using bridge lines or today teams. But I learned from DG Grossi that you guys quite effectively during the Ukraine incidents used streaming of news conferences. So the media did not need to come on site. You know, it was hybrid like this event is. So our staff is working very hard at trying to find ways for us to effectively get to all of the audiences that have a concern over a potential emergency. And that does, in fact, include some sort of hybrid event or live streaming. So I'm going to wrap up by just going, and let me address real quickly, Ben. There's a debate going on as to who the public is. And in my eyes, the public are all, I say my Aunt Evelyn, because if my Aunt Evelyn doesn't understand it, nobody understands it. You know, I have to communicate with her at the lowest level. So how do I get to my Aunt Evelyn? In part through the media, but they're reporting based upon how they feel the need to report. So we're now debating, how do we get to the public? Do we get to the public only through the media? Or do we have other mechanisms when there is emergency to get to the public? Some of you might remember some time ago, a US airplane went down having left LaGuardia Airport. It's the movie that Tom Hanks made about Captain Sullenberger. I used to work for that airline, and I knew, I spent 27 years there, and I knew Captain Sullenberger. And when the airplane went down, I immediately fired off a message to the chairman. I wasn't at the airline any longer, and I said, get out there. And he said, I don't have anything to say. And I said, the hell you don't. You get out there right now and say, we have an airplane that landed on the Hudson, and you don't have to speculate and say, I'm on my way to New York to deal with it. So he did it, and he got on a plane and he flew to New York. But MSNBC had somebody on the sideline, on the shoreline, that was tweeting everything that happened. You know, the airplane was floating, the wing was tipping, people were stepping out of the fuselage there, and the images you all saw about that. The airline took so long to tell the people what happened, these guys were driving the narrative, and they had to play a lot of defense, and luckily for them, nobody died as a result of you know, that smart decision by Captain Sullenberger. So I when I think about the media, I just have to say, don't speculate, but that doesn't mean you can't be out there giving updates based upon what you know. I know it's kind of dismissive to call it trickling, but if you can trickle information out there that keeps the information flowing, keeping the public aware that you're on it, that there aren't these long gaps, these long pits of information where you're relying on so-called experts, then you're going to be a lot more effective in what you do. So in summary for me, be prepared, be responsive, communicate, communicate, communicate. I call it the three C's, but that's pretty simple. I think a whole lot of people call it the three C's. Don't overreact, stay poised, show that you're calm, understanding, but also in control of the event. I've heard it said so many times today, and I still say we never practice what we preach. Communicate in plain language. Everybody at NRC are engineers or lawyers, and you know, for us to translate what they want us to say in language that my Aunt Evelyn will understand is really, you know, something that we work hard on. So please do, you know, consider making sure that your emergency plans are plain language. Keep people who are knowledgeable trained and prepared to go out and speak on your behalf. Your public affairs people can't be your only spokespeople. Subject matter experts need to be out there talking about the specifics of an emergency. And then lastly, learn from the last event. Don't just say we had an event and let's move on to what, God forbid, happens next. Learn from it, hot wash, do after actions, adjust, be agile, and then, you know, prepare your next action, your next training, based upon what you learn. Thank you for your attention.
Very good. Thank you for the wise words. Now, there is a reason why Ben came after David, so that Ben could have the last word on media. So please go for it.
Well, I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to get the last word. Hello, everyone. My name is Ben Weiss. I am currently a reporter covering Congress for Courthouse News Service here in Washington, but as of about a week and a half ago, I was covering the nuclear power industry for the Exchange Monitor. So I was very much in the trenches with all of you in the industry just a few short weeks ago. Thanks to Kathy and to NRC for organizing this today and for putting a reporter on the panel. You probably will not regret it. And thanks, Dave, for everything you said. I always find our conversations outside, off the record, and outside of my reporting duties very illuminating.
So you're just violating the belief that nothing's off the record.
Well, yeah. Actually, what I should say is everything that I say here today is my own opinion, and not reflective of the opinions of my current or former employers. I'm just speaking as a practitioner of the media and somebody who has been doing this for a little while. So on that note, I've been asked today to give you the reporter's perspective on crisis communications. So what that means is, you know, what we in the media need from federal agencies, from the industry, to inform the public during urgent developing events. I also imagine that I was asked to appear today because I am one of the few Gen Zers, I think the only Gen Zer on this panel, to my knowledge, in the industry. So as the ambassador for Zoomers today, I'm going to talk to you all in particular about new media and social media. And so I was glad to hear Peter and Dave talk a little bit about that, because I really do want to emphasize the role that social media plays in communicating with the public, and particularly communicating with the media. But before I do that, I want to climb up on my ivory tower a little bit and explain what my work was like covering agencies like NRC and nuclear power and the value that I think it brings to the broader conversation around nuclear power issues. So, also I should mention, I decided to forgo slide state because this vase has been strategically placed in the way of the slide deck. And also, like many of you, an end user of the information that is disseminated from agencies like NRC and from the nuclear industry. So I just felt like it was, you know, more personal to address the audience about these issues. So to go back to, you know, what I do as a reporter, I think if I had to sum up my experience covering nuclear power with one verb, it would be demystify. I don't think I'm overstepping my bounds by saying that the average person doesn't have what you might call an intimate knowledge of nuclear power issues. Before I started reporting on the industry in early 2021, all I knew about nuclear power was what I learned from the HBO Chernobyl miniseries, and I think that that's a pretty unique or not a unique experience for most people. So, you know, as a reporter covering nuclear power, it is my job to take the more obtuse parts of these issues. So, you know, how nuclear energy is regulated, how the public is nominally protected from radiation, how waste is handled. That was a big part of my beat. And I have to boil those things down so that while I'm reporting the news, I'm giving people the context that they need to fully understand what's going on. And so when things go wrong, you know, people don't just need to know what's happening, they need to understand how and why. And so I consider that to be part of my job as a reporter. That said, I am in sort of a unique position because over the last couple of years, I worked for a trade publication. And so my audience was largely people who sort of understood the basics of nuclear power issues. A lot of reporters, especially reporters who work local or national beats and don't cover nuclear power or even energy issues, so closely, it's possible that they lose some of the context or important information that needs to be disseminated to the public during an emergency situation. During a crisis, if you're not solid on the basics, that can be a problem. So I wanted to talk a little bit about where I think the industry and agencies can help with that. And the big thing is social media. And I don't necessarily mean social media in a traditional sense, in that I don't view social media as being a way to reach the general public, although it certainly is. I was happy to see NRC joined Instagram a couple months ago. I wrote about it when it happened, and they've become quite frequent posters, and I view their Instagram stories every time they're out. And things like that, I think, are good for humanizing the agency and getting people familiar with the kinds of work that people at the commission do and people in the nuclear power space do. But the reality is, the number of Americans who use social media is actually deceptively low, right? The statistic is, I think, 20% of Americans say that they are Twitter users. When you're posting as an agency or industry on Twitter, especially during a developing situation, you're actually not reaching as many people as you might be, as it might appear that you are. And so for me, as a reporter, I look at social media as a tool in my journalist toolkit. Sometimes, and I actually like that Dave, positions social media as complementary to press releases or to the public affairs office. Because sometimes as a reporter, you know, you find it difficult to get in touch with a public affairs officer, although, you know, I'll say I rarely had that problem at NRC. Sometimes it's difficult to get in touch with a public affairs officer during a developing situation, and so social media, having a little red phone on my desk, I don't know who's the U.S. and who's the Soviet Union in that analogy, having that direct line to the agencies is really, really vital. During a developing situation, having that constant open line of communication helps me turn around and disseminate information to the public that isn't necessarily receiving it. I was thinking of recent examples of this, and having been out of the industry now for a couple weeks, I've been focusing on so many more generalist subjects that it was sort of difficult to think back. But in late February, there was a minor fire at the NNSA's Y-12 complex. And I know that that's weapons complex stuff, but that was on my radar when it was happening. You might have read about it in the Exchange Monitor. The NNSA and Y-12's separate Twitter accounts, while that was happening, were pretty active throughout the day while that situation was developing, and were providing constant updates. And what I thought was particularly useful about that was that the agency's posts made clear what the perceived threat was, you know, how much the public should be concerned, and provided some provided that information that made it easier for people like me to turn it around and describe what was going on. I made it easier for someone who is less familiar with you know, what sort of work is done at Y-12 to understand exactly what the threat profile was and how that can be framed for an audience of generalists. You know, for a reporter, that's valuable information. As always, room for improvement. You know, it's my job to collect as much information as possible, so I always want to see agencies provide as much information as they can as quickly as possible. And I think that for, I like what Peter said about, you know, for agencies and for the industry, that demands a willingness to come to the table and actually make the effort to make that happen. I think that obviously there are some considerations in the way that get in the way, national security issues, proprietary information, that sort of stuff is, you know, as a reporter, you sort of have to work around those things. But, you know, I think when it comes to keeping the media and public informed, you should always strive for the most detail possible. The other thing, obviously, in addition to social media, is a strong public affairs office. Dave has attested to that. I think that's vital. I think an important facet of having a good public affairs officer as a complement to social media is someone who is happy to break down the minutia of more complicated issues. Like I said, when I first got involved, you know, I knew very little. I learned on the job, and having a public affairs officer, a trustworthy public affairs officer you can go to and say, you know, can you clarify this rulemaking for me? You know, I want to make sure that I get all my facts right. Having someone who's willing to break it down for you is useful for me as someone who was a specialist, but even more so for a generalist who, you know, doesn't work with these issues on a day-to-day basis. I think it's also worth mentioning, you know, when reporters are covering an issue, we're still reporters. We're still going to ask questions. Open line of communication is useful in that context, because you know, it gives us an avenue to be critical when things are developing, to ask the right sorts of questions, to hold agencies and industry to account when things go wrong, and you know, it's not necessarily the most fun experience to have a reporter in your mentions saying, hey, can you, you know, shed a little bit more light on why something like this happened. But it is vital for public accountability, and as a reporter, that's something that is crucial to me. So hearing directly from an agency as the situation is developing gives me, as a reporter, the tools that I need to ask pointed, informed questions about exactly what's happening. And I've spent a lot of time talking about the agencies, but I think that a lot of this stuff is applicable to industry as well. And you know, in my experience, sometimes industry public affairs and communications has been a bit more opaque than the agencies. So I think that this is useful. Social media strategy and public affairs strategy is useful for the industry as well. And I agree with David's point that that these sorts of strategies are not just unique to developing or crisis situations. A strong social media strategy is important during, you know, times where not a lot is going on, because, you know, as reporters who want to keep an eye on the agencies and what they're doing, having that little red phone it remains valuable even when there's, you know, not something urgent going on. At the end of the day, reporters covering nuclear power in any capacity have a pretty difficult task in front of them, especially if they lack fundamental knowledge of these issues. But it's an important job. It's important to demystify how the government industry are working on nuclear power issues for the public, and keeping them updated on how they're responding to crises or threats or nuclear safety and security. I think that the industry and government should and does have an interest in accomplishing that goal, and they can help facilitate it by leveraging the media tools available to them and providing a constant, clear stream of information which reporters can turn around and provide to the public. I'm not sure if I'm over time, but that's what I've got. So thanks for your time. I've only really scratched the surface of this topic, as I'm sure everyone else will talk about today. We could spend probably 4 hours talking about the positives and negatives of using social media to communicate with the public and with reporters. But I'm looking forward to having a larger conversation with that, and looking forward to your questions.
Thank you, Ben. Thanks for painting a picture of how we can all be partners in emergency communications. And Kathy, go ahead.
Okay. All right. Well, so I don't work for an agency. I'm not in the nuclear industry per se. I'm actually an academic. I'm not an engineer. I'm a scientist. So it's a little bit of a odd position. But I've been doing risk communication, and I guess you'd call me a subject matter expert. I'm a certified health physicist, and I've been doing work in nuclear adjacent stuff for almost 50 years now. And so I've finally gotten to the point in my life where I feel pretty comfortable talking about this. And I realize, you know, I sort of consider myself maybe a science whisperer a little bit, that I do research in a really, really obscure field. I mean, health physics is obscure. Radio ecology is like even more obscure. And that involves looking at radioactive materials moving through the environment, affecting people or ecosystems or non-human living things. And the work that I do, 99.999% of the time, doesn't rise to the level of interest to most anyone until maybe something happens, and then agencies can't respond quickly enough or feel constrained about what they can say. And I'm an academic, and academics are known for getting up and talking at length about just about anything. And I am able to answer questions, and I will, you know, I will qualify it, and I will tell people what I know and what I don't know. But I'm able to pick up a phone, sit for a Zoom call or whatever. And so that's made me over the years pretty available to folks to talk about a variety of subjects. So this is kind of what I'm going to be reflecting on. But again, the thing is, you know, the science that I do gets sort of reflected through a number of different lenses, from maybe, if I'm lucky, influencing policy in the government. There's a political lens that can come to play with any of the things that I do, particularly ecology, radio ecology, and then also the media. So any little bit of work I do can wind up knocking the microphone around, or I use my hands a lot too. So the major points that I want to make when I'm reflecting on the issue of risk communication is that it's really a two-way process. Academics are used to standing up in front of a group of people and lecturing till the students in the back go to sleep. And that's not really effective when you're trying to talk to somebody who is terrified. And for people that are working with a radiological release, it's an emergency, whether to a regulator or not, it's an emergency. To them, it's an emergency, and you need to figure out a way to communicate with them and get them the information that they need in order to make an appropriate decision, appropriate for them under those circumstances. So this is one of the things that I think it's important for people to understand. Now, again, I'm a health physicist. I teach this stuff at the university, and you need to keep up on the science. I would have said, you know, 10, 15 years ago, it was kind of, I don't know, the science seemed to be on autopilot, not a lot going on. Recently, a lot of changes, and it's really important as a professor, but also someone who communicates out to the general public, to really understand where the science is going. And because I'm an academic, I'm going to show you a couple of graphs, just because I can. And then when you talk to the public, at least for me, because I reach out to communities that are impacted, maybe because of a cleanup that didn't quite go the way that people expected, or somebody found a radionuclide in an area that they didn't anticipate it, you need to be able to talk to folks. And you know, if you're helicoptered into a situation, you know, you're an expert, but you're also viewed as not from that community, and why should anybody trust you? And so one of the things that you need to do in these sorts of circumstances is bring your whole self to this conversation so that people can see you as not just a tool of the man, that's an old person's bit, but as an honest to God, authentic individual that you can have a conversation with. So you need to bring your experience to the discussion. So communication is two-way. And one of the things that bugs me, both as a scientist, as a health physicist, and I guess thirdly, in the risk communication, is that oftentimes people are nervous about having to make a statement to the public. And so they have like their flashcards of radiation factoids that they can, you know, quickly work through. And okay, I've got a relevant factoid: bananas. You get dosed from eating bananas. Well, I want to put a stake through the heart. Bananas don't have hearts, and probably a stake wouldn't work. But I want anybody who uses that as an analogy to just stop it, because it's wrong. For the science nerds in the audience, you know, the dose from bananas is from potassium 40. Your body regulates potassium really, really tightly. So if you eat a banana for a little bit, you have more potassium, but then your body goes, I'm getting rid of the excess stuff out some way. We won't go into that. So, you know, make sure if you're using examples that they're actually relevant and scientifically based. Another thing is, you know, we tend to have these great graphics. We talk about the pathways of exposure, and we show how people are potentially exposed from a release from a plant. And I don't know if you guys in the all-encompassing general sense, I don't know if people in the audience can see this image in the middle, but it shows sort of a generic facility releasing stuff going to some large trout-like thing and impacting a guy in a blue suit. And that's probably not your target audience, right? So if you're wanting to talk about release of radioactivity through the environment, impacting the general public, suit guy is probably not it. So ask your graphics department to make something a little more relevant to the population that you're going to be talking to, so that again, they see you as a person that actually is trying to understand their circumstances. And another example is this radiation thermometer. And again, EPA uses it, DOE uses it, and it has different sources of radiation and what you might see. On there is an example of the dose you get from a plane flight from Seattle to Washington, D.C. Well, if you're talking to a community in Piketon, Ohio, why on earth would they be on a plane from Seattle to D.C.? How is that relevant? If it's a community that's pretty impoverished, plane flights may be a thing of aspiration, but not reality. So again, make sure your examples are appropriate to the community that you're addressing. A bit about the science. So here's a graph that looks at you know, radiation risk versus dose. Now, again, for the science nerds in the background, we've been studying radiation for over 100 years. Really serious epidemiology has been going on since the atomic weapons detonation, or a few years after in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. We've got a lot of data on the effects of radiation in the high dose range. And we continue to follow different populations. There's a talk in another session later today, I think, that's going to touch on the million worker study. And the thing is that you know, we have this information out in the high doses. We can put all sorts of different mathematical models to explain that response, and we typically are regulating down in the lower regions. Now, if you want to see two health physicists knock the living crap out of each other, you can either advocate for the linear no threshold model, or you can advocate for hormesis or a threshold. And you know, right now it's a hot topic in health physics meetings, and people literally are yelling at each other about it. But I think the important thing is you have to keep this in perspective, right? We have data on doses above about 10,000 millirem. Science is going to move our knowledge, again, I hit the mic, sorry. Science is going to move our knowledge into lower dose regions, but we're regulating occupational doses below the level where we see effects. Public exposures and public regulations are way, way, way down in the weeds. And so the big takeaway from this is that, you know, it doesn't really matter what mathematical model you use to predict risk down in this really low region. It could be a threshold, it could be linear, it could be whatever. The risk is low to nothing down in the very low region where we regulate groundwater, we do cleanups, we regulate emissions from a number of plants. So you need to keep this in perspective. When I say bring all your experience to the discussion, I absolutely mean that. I've been working in this field for nearly 50 years, from research reactors to power reactors to weapons cleanup to laboratory research. But I'm an academic, I educate students and I turn them loose on society, God help you all. But I'm a parent and I love being in the outdoors. I'm a pet owner, you know, or a pet parent, depending on your inclination. I'm also a cartoon character, or I was. So when you go to talk to a community, don't just wear the one hat of, I'm a regulator. It's, you're a person, and try and relate to the group that you're dealing with in all of these different facets of yourself. So the final elevator pitch to this group is, you know, when you're communicating, listen to your audience. Never stop trying to communicate. It's really important. Be bullheaded, be dogged. Take that feedback, try another approach. Understand your subject or let somebody else talk about it. And also be honest about what you know and what you don't know. I really want you to try and avoid canned sound bites because it makes it look like you're phoning it in. And try to be honest and authentic. Don't take things personally. You will get yelled at. You will be called a tool of the man or what have you. But again, I had teenagers. I mean, they're now out of that phase, but I'm used to being yelled at and really trying not to take it personally. And finally, don't be overly impressed with yourself because you're going to mess up. At some point, you're going to say something stupid and people are going to call you on it. So you need to take that into account as well. So I just wanted to say thank you for the opportunity, Kathy. I very much appreciate being part of this panel. And if anybody wants to get a hold of me, there you go.
Oh, thank you, Kathy. That was great tips. Thank you. Agnieszka, you're ready for the Poland experience.
Thank you. So good afternoon. I'm Agnieszka Makosa, and I'm from Poland, and I work as a spokesperson at the National Atomic Energy Agency of the Republic of Poland. And today we are talking about crisis communication, but I want to focus on two main challenges that are important now and will be in the future, as this week is for navigating the future. So let me tell you something about, of course, our crisis communication due to the war, but also our communications plans with reference to Polish nuclear power program. But first, let me introduce myself just a little bit, not myself, but the agency, I'm sorry. So we are the Polish regulator that operates since 1982. So last year we turned 40. We supervise 4 nuclear facilities that are in Poland and present. It is 1 research reactor in operation, 1 research reactor decommissioned, and 2 spent fuel storages. We also supervise more than 7,000 activities that use ionizing radiation. We also run radiation monitoring in Poland. So these are the main activities. There's no need to talk about the others. And of course, we are working on the basis of law, and the atomic law also set the scope of our activities also in communication field, but we are doing much more than law requires from us. And when it comes to the communication in crisis, of course, we need to respond. When it comes to last year, the war in Ukraine. Of course, I suppose that for many of you, it was very intense, very difficult time to communicate, especially if you are from regulator all over the world. But we can suppose that there is more precariousness, there is more fear in the society, and there are more questions also to the regulator when the war is just behind your border. So this is an unprecedented situation, that nuclear facilities in the heat of war, and all this is happening so close to us. When it comes to our crisis communication due to the war, we had and still have some main goals. First of all, thinking about the public, about the Polish people, and seeing them sometimes even petrified. We had many calls from the people that were frightened, and they were very unaware. We decided to, first of all, inform them about current radiation situation in Poland. And we use Twitter. It is a very good tool for this kind of communication because it gives you an opportunity to contact directly with some responders that are not only journalists. The other thing we are doing with reference to this crisis is to respond in emergencies, and we try to react prompt. It doesn't mean that we are chasing with journalists. We don't want to be the first. We want to be the most accuracy. And we inform public only when we have a confirmation from the IAEA or our colleagues from SNRU. By the way, thank you for respond to us so quickly and answering our emails in case of emergencies. When it comes to this kind of response, it is important what we are saying. It's not worth to be quiet. It's always worth to say something. For instance, it was at the beginning of March where Russian troops took over Zaporizhia nuclear power plant, and it was in the middle of the night that we received first notification from USEA. And what we have done, first we decided to put a Twitter. It was a very short tweet, but it was in the middle of the night or very early in the morning, maybe 4 or 5 p.m. Then within a couple of hours, there was a press conference all together with the president of the PAA and the Ministry of Climate and the Environment. And of course, during this event, there was an opportunity to provide public and the journalists with more information. So we tried to steady inform the public about what is going on and what does it mean. And we also publish announcements with reference to emergencies in Ukraine. We try to use plain language. It is, yeah, what you are saying. It is very important to say by plain language. Don't use jargon, don't be so technical, because what we want is to be understood by the public. So it is very important to speak in a plain language. And another thing we are doing within this crisis communication is to fight fake news and the struggle with disinformation. For instance, there were many fake news about radiation clouds that is moving towards Poland and may be harmful for the public. Of course, we tried to fight them, to say that it's not true, and to provide public with the relevant information. Always, we always also ask the public to look for the sources for the sources of information. As you know, media, internet is full of disinformation, and it's very important, especially in the crisis, to have this information from the right source. We also want to promote good behaviors among Polish people, as especially at the very beginning of war, there was a massive purchase of iodine pills from the pharmacies, so the shelves were empty. What we need to do, knowing that, was of course to tell people that it is harmful to take iodine pills with no reason, etc., etc. So these activities has the main aim, and the main aim for us at present is to calm down the public, is to ease negative emotions. And yeah, this is what we are focusing now. And this slide represents some of our activities. There were press conferences with representatives of Polish governments. It one with the Ministry of Climate and the Environment. It was about Zaporozhye. And the second with the Deputy Minister of the Interior and Administration. It was about stable iodine. Of course, plenty of interviews, radio, television, internet. Of course, plenty of questions from journalists as well as from ordinary people. When it comes to the tools, well, we try to use maybe not everything, but of course social media. You know that the audience of this media is getting wider and wider. I suppose that now it's about 5 billion users throughout the world. So it's a perfect tool to communicate to the public, especially when you want to communicate steadily. And of course, we use traditional media, like, you know, radio, television. And we also want to introduce to the public our experts, because, yeah, this is what you are talking about. It is important to give the institution a professional face, the face that can, you know, build a trust of the other, people. And the conclusions after first year of war, certainly. First, the war boosted interests of media and the public of our institution. It's not a surprise, I suppose, but it is very visible, especially on our Twitter account, that within the last 12 months, the number of followers on our Twitter account increased fivefold. So now it's a huge number in comparison with the February 2022. And the second, yeah, when it comes to Polish people, the war shows us that they still have in their memory 1986, so Chernobyl, and they are still afraid of ionizing radiation. So these two are the main conclusions, and despite these fears, despite the threats, it is distinctive in Poland that now we have very high rate for approval for Polish governments of building nuclear power plants. Why am I talking this? Because I want to move smoothly to another challenge. I want to tell you just a little, because you know time is ticking away, and I don't want to take this time. So the other challenge for us in the future will be to communicate about Polish nuclear power program. As you may know, Polish government wants to build from 6 to up to 9 reactors in Poland, from 2 to 3 units. Last year, they have chosen technical partner for first unit. You may know it's Westinghouse and AP1000. So it is all happening. And for us, it's a huge challenge, of course, for the agency, but for us, the people that we are dealing with communications, and what are we going to do, or what are we doing? Of course, now we are using many tools to first to introduce to the public, despite the fact that, you know, war boosted our, let's say, popularity. Many people in Poland don't even know that National Atomic Energy Agency exists. And if they know, sometimes they wrongly think about our responsibility in this program. So we need to use many tools to introduce ourselves, to talk about nuclear security and radiological protection. Of course, we want to use our experts, because it's important, as I mentioned. And of course, we have 21st century. It is always worth to use this digital tools to communicate to the public. But sometimes, in our opinion, it is worth to use old-fashioned tools like meeting the public in person. And this is also what we are going to do with reference to the program. We are going to meet the public in person, especially from the preferred location. The name for this location is Lubiatowa Kopalino, and it is in Pomeranian province. And another thing we will need to do is to organize an administrative hearing that will be open to public. And yeah, it's going to be another big challenge for us. We do hope that we will do our best to meet all the requirements. And thank you for your attention.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Roman.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, dear colleagues. I am Roman Khlenko, and I represent Nuclear Regulatory Inspectorate of Ukraine. Couple words about state nuclear regulatory inspectorates. It was established according to decree of President of Ukraine in December 2000 as an independent nuclear regulator. Previously, we were inside of different ministries, and since 2000, we are independent. At present time, we operate under our statute that was approved by Cabinet of Ministers of Ukraine in August 2014. It was the last update of the statute. And we report directly to the Cabinet of Ministers. Regarding the topics of our here and today is why the communication, why we should communicate to people. It's a simple answer because according to the main law of Ukraine in the sphere of nuclear safety, it's on use of nuclear energy and radiation safety, article number 24, prompt notification by mass media of radiation accidents on territory of Ukraine and beyond its boundaries in case of transboundary release is one of the competence of state nuclear regulator. Beginning on February 24th last year till present day, everybody knows we are under war condition. At that day, emergency and our emergency center was activated, and till today it works every day, every night, 24/7. Since the last year, we suffered Chernobyl nuclear power plant, exclusion zone, Zaporizhzhia nuclear power plant, research reactor installation at the Kharkov Institute of Physics and Technology, Rad waste management facilities in Kyiv, Kharkiv, the name is radon, and almost all nuclear and radiation sources at the territories of Ukraine that were captured by Russian Federation. The threats we face at, in this time is military invasion into nuclear power plants and contaminated territory at the Chernobyl exclusion zone, bombing and shelling the nuclear installations and drug waste management installations, missiles and military planes over nuclear power plant sites, loss or lack of communication, and the impossibility to restore and destroy infrastructure and logistics, and very important, the threat it fakes and lies that we should to improve. challenges for the staff of SNRU at self-organizations, because since the invasion starts, the almost all staff of a regulatory body lived in Kyiv was moved to the western part of Ukraine, southern part of Ukraine. The Kyiv was almost blocked by Russian forces. And regarding to my department of nuclear installations safety, we for the first month had only 6 people who were on their jobs in person. Other people, other our colleagues, were accessible only through the remote mode. What is we established communication in targeted groups. We divided public in some targeted groups. It was general public, as our, my colleague said, whom we should provide information in the simplest manner, the executive body and cabinet of ministers, but we should explain what happens and what is probable consequences. Professional society, it's a nuclear, scientific, medical, first responders, whom we provided information regarding their requests, and international communities and non-government organizations whom we communicated as much as we could and as fast as we could. Tools we used, it's internet, website, social media, interviews in media, or open letters, emails, meetings, consultations, discussions, personal explanations. Main topics, what we are trying to reflect in our information is verifying and providing real information on the status of nuclear power plants, situation in the Chernobyl exclusion zone, the damages that we seen in nuclear infrastructure. Also, we provide information on the radiation monitoring in the case of, as Agnieszka said, iodine prophylaxis, rumors and fakes. We had to to improve this information. We provide information to our colleagues in IAEA and as well as we ask the assistance which we need in these circumstances. Sorry, my English a little bit bad. As an example, from February 24th, on website of SNRU was submitted more than 300 publications in Ukrainian, more than 80 publications in English during the first 100 days of invasion. In Facebook, we provided publications in Ukrainian, in English. In the first days of invasion, it was up to 8 publications. Later, two to five per day. And as just after the invasion, the messenger Telegram, as was mentioned previously, was very popular in Ukraine, and we began start messaging in the Telegram. We created a special news page in Telegram, and people could refer for information. Acting chairman, Mr. Oleg Korikov, actively took part in television programs, conducted a lot of interviews, different media, TV programs. Also, we have such tool in the regulatory body as public counsel, that helps provide information to public and to professional societies. On May 26-27, we had a special council. We met them, and on a regular basis since that time, we informed them about everything that happens in nuclear installations in Ukraine. Beside the regulatory body, we have very strong support from our technical support organization, Scientific Center of Nuclear and Radiation Safety. As well as the regulatory body, they inform the public, their colleagues regarding the situation on through their website, Facebook page. What we have learned from our communication with public, what they were interested. Nuclear and radiation issues is a possibility and possibility of disaster, as it was at Chernobyl nuclear plant, was the one of the main concern of the public of Ukraine. And the non-radiation issue that was very interesting to the public is necessity to leave homes, again, especially for the people who suffered at Chernobyl disaster that was in 1986. And they should be evacuated from this exclusion zone. I was prepared for 5 minutes, but thank you very much.
Wonderful.
And thank you very much. I would like to thank my colleagues and all the colleagues through the world who assist us, who helped us, and again, thank you.
No. Well, can we give a round of applause to everyone before we get to the public? Just an outstanding panel. This has been great. I really appreciate everyone. And I even have a comment in the list of questions about what a great panel it is and how nice to have great communicators. So I think we'll only have time for a couple, so I'll pick and choose here. Dr. Higley, we have a question for you. It's a tough one. You mentioned terrified member of the public. From what we've seen over the years, people are concerned, but that doesn't mean they're terrified. They may have questions and concerns. Perhaps as communicators, we may need to change our perspectives on the people we're trying to reach. That might help us do a better job when we communicate. If
thoughts on that?
So I would push back on that a little bit. And following the Fukushima accident, there was, again, a sort of a vacuum of people being able to communicate. And so as an academic, I was speaking to folks. And I had people, one woman in particular called from California. She was a goat owner, herder, and she was terrified, literally terrified, that radioactivity coming from the Fukushima plant would come to California and kill her animals. And so she had brought them all in her house with her. And so you have to go through the discussion about how far away it is and dilution and the fact that it's going to be very difficult to even detect it. So in certain circumstances, people are literally terrified. And so you need to recognize it and not minimize and downplay their concern.
Okay. Thank you. Agnieszka, we have a question for you. You mentioned that people still very much remember Chernobyl. And they're concerned about ionizing radiation. The question is, what about the demographics? Are the younger people who weren't around for Chernobyl as worried as the older generation that lived through it?
Can you just repeat the last sentence of the question?
Are people in Poland who were not alive during Chernobyl still feel the same fear that the older generation feel?
It's hard to answer for all the young people that are in Poland, but supposedly no. Of course, we could have seen that the biggest fear were among the elderly people that, you know, remember that date, that maybe as a child they had to go to doctor and drink Lugola's liquid. This is the name for the medicine with stable iodine, because at the time Poland was the country in which we decided, it wasn't not us, but the government and the institutions responsible for nuclear security and radiological protection decided to give to the public stable iodine. So I think that young people, of course, react different, and the most fear was among elderly people.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. This one's for Ben. Very often, media outlets send out copies of tweets or Instagram. How does this figure into how much of the public receives information that NRC might send out via social media?
Send out copies, meaning?
Retweets.
Oh, I see. Yeah, I mean, I think that there is a danger in media outlets retweeting statements from anyone, but, you know, agencies and industry fall into this category. You know, reposting those things verbatim and uncritically. Like I said, I think the way I think about social media is the number of people that are going to see a retweet is, you know, lower than people who might, you know, read about what an agency said on Twitter in a story. And that's why at first I thought you were referring to like embedding a tweet in a story, which I think is actually almost a more valuable vehicle for communicating what an agency is saying on social media through the media. In my experience, in my reporting experience, I always make a point when things are developing to, you know, include, you know, obviously what an agency says in print, but if there's media available, to include it, you know, in a little box on my copy, so that anyone reading my work can also see concurrently what the agency is saying. So I'm surrounding, you know, the statement that's being made with my own original reporting. So I think that amplifying, you know, the message of an agency or an entity that's trying to disseminate their information via social media on social media is valuable. I think that there's the other ways that can be employed to reach a broader audience.
Okay, thank you. We have one last question. It's for David, and we have 2 minutes left. So I'll just say.
I can't do it in 2 minutes. Thank you all.
What evidence do you have that supports your statement that the public doesn't trust the NRC?
They tell us. It's pretty simple. They tell us. You know, it doesn't take much for people to tell you what they don't like. It takes a lot for people to tell you what they do like, but when they don't trust you, they tell you that. And you see it in social media comments when we put things out. When we have end-of-cycle meetings, the people who don't care for nuclear, don't trust us, stand right up and just tell you to your face, we don't believe you, you're liars, you're whatever words they choose to use to amplify that. So we know it, we recognize it, we try to change that thinking. You have to manage the expectations and say, I will only get so far, but you have to keep trying. But okay. They tell us, listen.
Great answer, thank you very much. Mm-hmm. And I think with that, we'll close the session, but the panel, who've just been amazing, thank you. We can remain up here for a little bit because there were many questions we didn't get to, so thanks.